Welcome to the Taubman Museum of Art. I'm Cindy Petersen, the museum's executive director, and we're at the David and Susan Good Gallery, Regional Gallery here with Dr. Patrick Shaw Cable, our chief curator and deputy director of exhibitions and collections. And we are standing here with the Dorothy Gillespie newly installed exhibition. And I want to give a shout out and thank our sponsors that made this happen in that support of the Rhode Oak Arts Commission with additional support from the Dorothy M. Gillespie Foundation and Susan and Jeff Jennings. But with that, I'll hand it over to Patrick to lead us into the exhibition. And we already can see the vibrancy of Dorothy's work.
Yes, this was a really fun show to put together and to view. We take a whimsical approach to the installation and the layout. This exhibition is complementing an exhibition soon to come, Celestial Centennial, the Art and Legacy of Dorothy Gillespie, but this called Dorothy Gillespie, Still Enchanting Virginia's Blue Ridge, is all from regional private collections. And so in honor of that concept of private collecting, where you hang things where you wish in your own home, and also Dorothy Gillespie's approach where sometimes her abstraction, she might hang horizontally and then she might change and hang the same piece vertically the next time. We decided to take a more whimsical approach to layout. And this first example is a really good example of that. It's from the collection of Merle and Lorraine Jones in Radford. And originally they had this installed in a house with taller ceilings. And when they moved, the artist suggested it was hanging vertically, one on top of the other. So it took up more space. Height-wise, she said, well, now you have lower ceilings, just hang it diagonally. So we decided to do that here as well.
Well, and Dorothy gives it such whimsical names as well. This one is called Magic Carpet Slide, and you can really feel like it's a carpet, and you're sliding down the aluminum. And we have a number of Dorothy's work in our permanent collection, including Winter Palace, and that'll be installed soon in our interactive area. And that's one of my favorite pieces because as you hear the name and then you see the piece, it just comes alive and you feel like you're ice skating.
Yes, and Dorothy did that a lot with her abstractions. Again, she came up with this hallmark abstract style of painted and cut metalwork, but she more often than not gave very evocative titles. So she wanted her abstractions to bespeak emotion, joy, or the response to nature. There are a lot of really wonderful titles. Royal Wind Chimes, Hidden Passage in the Secret Valley.
Well, and it's a very distinct style of sculpture and design, as you mentioned. And when you're traveling, you can see it in different places, including the Mayo Clinic, Epcot Center, Lincoln Center, some of the airports like Fort Lauderdale. And as we were exploring this exhibition and what would be included, we also saw a number of photographs from outdoor sculptures, including the Rockefeller.
Yes.
And that is really tall ones. And I know up at Radford University, there's a number of outdoor sculptures that's included in the exhibition.
And that's another wonderful feature of her work. She really wanted to share her art with the community. Some of the works here were actually gifts to the collectors, a few of them. But also on that large scale, she was very committed to making public art. The Rockefeller Center, for example, was in 2003. There's a video of her there during installation. So she really wanted to respond to the architecture in a sensitive way and share her art with the public. And then we have a work in this room that's actually ink, very darkly inked paper, black ink on paper with some watercolor, but a black, gray, and white work. And it's interesting because she really credited her works on paper as a foundational element for her later works in metal that were her hallmark. So she worked and formed these pieces while the paper was still wet with pigment and ink and water, and then make the curls. And then eventually she began to, for example, mount paper on perhaps galvanized steel background and did the curls. And then she finally realized also that aluminum was just as flexible as thick paper, but more sturdy, again, for her outdoor works and works she wanted to share with the public. They could be installed outside or inside. So that really led her to these final groundbreaking works in painted and cut metal.
And I love how you did the juxtaposition with the ink and acrylic on paper scene, and then right next to the black and white Phantom Rhapsody, which is from the collection of Judy and Jill Tenzer here in Roanoke. And this is one that I love seeing in their home because it really stood out with that black and white. And it's not, there's not that many with the black and white. We have another one that shows a good example of a tabletop Starburst loan from the collector Ed Hall. So that shows different ways that she and what she used within her artwork.
Oh, definitely. Yeah. Speaking of that black and white piece, it's interesting because it has its own, you almost might want to say, color, even though it's black and white. It has some grays, and then just with the ribbon effect. And that was something she was always interested in, not only color, but also black and white or dark and light, and the interplay between positive and negative. So this, even again, as Cindy said, even though it's a limited color palette, it feels just as joyful and light-filled as her other work.
Well, and just like Dorothy was experimenting with different materials, that's what we're doing as well. So always reusing and renovating pieces. And so we took a jewelry holder, we're gonna paint it white, and the educators have come up with the idea where we have different ribbon with wire and colors. So you can see, we're just being in this space, how you can create your own work of art and experiment in that fashion with color, with size, and with that curling effect like she has. So that'll be coming up in our interactive area along with a map. So a walking map and a driving map. So there's so many, as I mentioned, throughout the US, but just here in the area. As you walk into Jefferson Center, there is a piece. As you walk into Center in the Square, and most recently, as we were at the opening at Melrose Library, there's Gary Israel, her oldest son that we've been working with, and he's really is celebrating throughout the country her centennial, and donated a number of pieces to the Melrose Library.
And then this week we'll be installing Celestial Celebration, Celestial Centennial, the Art and Legacy of Dorothy Gillespie. But the two complimentary shows, again, this private collection show really underlines how beloved she is in the region, and that's partly because of her close relationships with many of these collectors and also her commitment to the region. She came back and taught many different times under different guises, the Governor's School as Distinguished Professor of Art at Radford University. And then the next exhibition that we're installing this week will really provide an outline throughout her career, starting with abstract expressionist paintings up to her mature metalwork paintings, wall sculptures.
Well, I'm really excited to see the install of that, and in another segment we'll be showing a time lapse. But Dorothy, you hit it right on the nail. She was an educator by heart, and her son is always, you know, talking about that love, the love for the students, the love for experimentation and process and showing. And that's one of the elements that will show her here at the Taubman Museum of Art. And just thinking about color, light, and legacy of Dorothy Gillespie.